Well, in spite of all the vivid images that that music evokes, I want to assure you I'm not here to deliver a lecture about the cheetahs of the Serengeti Plain. Good evening, I'm Jim Schweda from Classical KUSC. And that very familiar music which you just heard, which still introduces programs on the National Geographic Channel, is one of dozens of works by one man which have long since become part of the fabric of American life. In fact, with the possible exception of one of his biggest fans, John Williams, it's difficult to think of another film composer who wrote more music that's central to American life than Elmer Bernstein. In all, Elmer produced more than 150 film scores. He worked on nearly 100 TV projects. He wrote dozens of other works, including that wonderful late guitar concerto for Chris Parkening. And although one or two film composers may actually have written more actual scores, no one ever worked at it longer than Elmer did. In a profession which has many practitioners whose careers can be counted in months, Elmer worked in Hollywood for an incredible 54 years. Yet even more astonishing than his unprecedented longevity was his equally jaw-dropping versatility. No composer wrote more distinguished scores for more different kinds of films, from classic comedies like Ghostbusters and Animal House to serious dramas like To Kill a Mockingbird and the last eight westerns that John Wayne made. And apparently that ability to write exactly what the project needed was something that Elmer Bernstein understood from the very beginning. In fact, in his breakthrough year of 1956, he worked on two films that literally couldn't be more different. Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments, and with its gritty, revolutionary jazz score, Otto Preminger's The Man with the Golden Gun. And even more unbelievably, there was actually a period when he worked on both of those scores simultaneously and didn't get confused. In fact, one day on the set of The Ten Commandments, Cecil B. DeMille called Elmer into his office and said, "Well, last night at home, I screened The Man with the Golden Arm." And Elmer said, "I was afraid of that." At which point DeMille said, No. It was very good. It's very good. You're just not planning to do anything like that for the Ten Commandments, are you?" Well, tonight's concert, which is being recorded for future broadcast on KUSC, pays tribute to this giant of film music, whose family has recently donated all of Elmer's scores and recordings and photographs and memorabilia to USC, so that future film historians and students of film music can better understand what it was that made Elmer so unique. Our conductor tonight, David Speer, worked with Elmer for years, orchestrating his film scores and serving as the music director for Elmer's Broadway musical, Merlin. In a few minutes, we're going to hear from Peter Bernstein, who's going to talk about his father and conduct several rarely heard movie themes. Director John Landis is going to share some of his memories of his friend and collaborator. And later, we're going to hear the USC Jazz Band in two justly famous jazz pieces that Elmer wrote for films in the 1950s. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back David Speer, who's going to conduct the continue the concert with Elmer Bernstein's best-known march. Here is David Speer to conduct the USC Thornton Symphony in the main title music from The Great Escape. Thank you.
When the program for this concert was first being discussed, I had the idea of debuting a never-before piece of music from my father's works. After 54 years of composing, there was a lot to choose from, and I was a bit lost. So I asked a few people who were familiar with the work what they would like to hear. And when every person named a different piece, the single piece debut evolved into a medley of parts of pieces that have been performed never or rarely. They are Silver, from the album Tone Poems of Color, commissioned and conducted by Frank Sinatra in 1956. Two pieces from the unused and never heard score from The Journey of Natty Gann, 1984. One piece from the unused and never heard score from A River Runs Through It, 1992. A very small part of the love theme from Desire Under the Elms, 1958. And finally, The March from Stripes, which has been heard many times, but never or rarely, I'm not sure which, performed in public. Time constraints prevent us from giving more than a small glimpse into the huge amount of music that is written during a productive lifetime of composing. Some film scores are thrown out, some films are thrown out, and the scores go with them, but the music is here now, waiting for someone to come and listen to it.
Thank you. Hi. My name is John Landis, and you have... You're applauding, they're leaving. Anyway, I apologize for my voice, which I left in Vancouver. I also apologize for my very chaotic speech, which I wrote in a panic. I've been shooting, I just got here. But I'm very happy I got here in time for that. That's the end credit medley for Three Amigos, a movie Elmer kindly wrote the score for me. It's a medley, and you can hear pieces, but the score for Three Amigos is a particular place in my heart because I asked Elmer Bernstein to make fun of Elmer Bernstein. And he did a fabulous job. The score for that movie really is something, especially you're going to hear The Magnificent Seven later tonight. And anyway, okay, this is what I wrote so far. I went to school for 2 years with Peter Bernstein. So that guy who was here earlier. So I first met Peter's father, Elmer Bernstein, when I was 15 years old. 12 years later, I asked Elmer to write the score for my first studio motion picture, Animal House. Elmer, by then, had had quite a career and had been typecast many times. He was Mr. Jazz, known for the scores of things like, Sweet Smell of Success and The Man with the Golden Arm, Walk on the Wild Side, these big, brassy, bold, dynamic scores. That's what he did, Elmer Bernstein. But then he suddenly was doing movies like To Kill a Mockingbird and Birdman of Alcatraz, and suddenly he became Mr. Dramatic Picture, Mr. Important, until he actually did The Magnificent Seven, and then he was screwed because he became Mr. Western. He did so many Westerns. When I told the music department at Universal, I said, who do you want to score the film? I said, well, I was thinking of asking Elmer Bernstein. They looked at me like, he won't even take your call, you know. But I thought, yes, he will. So I showed the movie to Elmer, and he said, well, yeah, I think it's very funny. Why do you want me? And it was like, because you're brilliant, and you'll make it better. And what I asked Elmer to do was treat it as a drama. Well, poor Elmer, after being Mr. Jazz and Mr. Western and Mr. War Movie and Mr. Biblical Epic and all the things he was typed as, he became Mr. Comedy in a very bizarre way, because within moments of Animal House, he became the composer of scores for not only Ghostbusters and Airplane and Trading Places and Stripes and Three Amigos and God knows what else, but the most successful comedies of all time, and he couldn't get a real job. He used to call me and say, John, I hate your guts. They think I'm kidding. Very quickly, just a couple of things that I wrote down really quick about Elmer. I'm sure you all know he was a child prodigy, a piano player. He was a protege of Aaron Copland. He was the rehearsal pianist for Agnes DeMille's dance troupe, which is how he got the Ten Commandments, because her brother was connected in Hollywood. DeMille, Elmer's favorite story, and I'm gonna screw this up. Okay, you'll forgive me. Turandot is the Chinese opera, right? It's about, yes? And that's written by Puccini. Okay, Madame Butterfly is the Japanese, and that's written by, okay, good. Because the story that Elmer told to great delight in, what happened was he was the rehearsal pianist for Agnes DeMille's group, and Mr. DeMille said, you, Agnes, you do Egyptian kind of choreography. So I don't know if you know this, but no one knows what ancient Egyptian music sounds like. No, that's true. They know what ancient Greek and Roman music sounds like, but they haven't a clue what ancient Egyptian music sounds like. We have a lot of pictures of instruments. So Elmer was asked to come up with, you know, ancient Egyptian music kind of stuff that you could play on a lute and like look, sound good. And so Elmer did, and he was playing it, and DeMille went, that's very good. that's very good. And suddenly, I think he was 27. How old was Elmer when he did it? He became Cecil B. DeMille's composer, and DeMille said to him, and Elmer loved to tell the story, that, Elmer, I want you to do for me, I want you to do for Egyptian music what Puccini did for Chinese music. All right, one last thing. Oh! Well, what did my favorite Elmer Bernstein credit, because I was born in 1950, so I grew up with Mary Martin's Peter Pan, remember on Thanksgiving, the Comden and Green Peter Pan. Elmer Bernstein was the pit pianist when that was on Broadway. And guess what he composed and played? He was Tinkerbell. That was Elmer Bernstein. You didn't know that. Anyway, he was truly a great man. He really was extraordinary. And aside from giving me Peter, he also had such an impact on the culture. I have to tell you, when you listen to that little piece from The Great Escape, do you know that that's the British soccer cup theme? So when you're in England and there's a soccer game, you can't help but hear that goddamn music over and over, you know. All right, this is how I leave you. Okay, these guys, Otto Preminger, Cecil B. DeMille, Delbert Mann, J. Lee Thompson, Martin Scorsese, John Sturges, Alan Pakula, Marty Ritt, John Frankenheimer, George Roy Hill, Robert Mulligan, Stephen Frears, Don Siegel, Todd Haynes, William Wyler, Henry Hathaway, Ivan Reitman, Sidney Pollack. That's all I could think of on the way over here. But all those gentlemen and I, we share something really special, which is that Elmer Bernstein made our movies better.
Elmer Bernstein said on many occasions that what really interested him most in music and in movies was all kind of energy. And it's difficult to think of another body of film music in which so many kinds of energy are so vividly and abundantly displayed. But then again, it's impossible to think of another composer who actually loved movies as much as Elmer Bernstein did. In what would prove to be the last radio program we ever did together, he said with all the energy and enthusiasm of a little kid, "Imagine, I get to go to a studio screening room at 10 in the morning and see a movie that only a handful of people have ever seen before. And it's free." Well, the last three pieces on tonight's concert capture that unique energy and enthusiasm as well as any of the hundreds we could have chosen. Music from the Ten Commandments, music from To Kill a Mockingbird, and some music from a classic Western that's going to need absolutely no introduction. Once again, please welcome conductor David Speer and the USC Thornton Symphony playing the music of Elmer Bernstein.
Thank you.
Thank you.